The Son and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen.
The gospel of this morning is about discipleship. But there is something of an odd turn towards, or may seem like an odd turn towards the end. It starts off with talking about the cost of discipleship, that even those who love their siblings, they love their parents, they love themselves more than Christ, they are not worthy to be his disciples. It's talking about the high cost of discipleship and how those who are entering into this relationship with Christ, those who want to be his disciples, must understand that it comes at a cost. But then, as you heard at the end, it turns to salt. What does salt have to do with anything? On one hand, it seems like it turns to a different topic. On the other, it's really the same theme, this notion of salt. Christ is getting to the same idea from a different angle. The basic question is, what do you do with something that has one purpose and fails to live up to that purpose? And salt is a really interesting example. It's a great example because salt is very distinct. It's clear. Once you taste something that is salty, you know what it is. You don't have to kind of put it on your palate and think, what am I tasting? What is this? I'm sure you've all seen one cooking show or another where they do kind of a blind taste test and they have them try this ingredient or that ingredient blindfolded and they try to guess, and half the time they're guessing wrong. But they never do that with salt. Salt is very distinct. Salt is clear. Salt is unmistakable. You are either salt or you are not salt. Similarly, with the gospel of this morning, with the emphasis on discipleship, Christ is saying you're either a disciple or you're not a disciple. There is no gray area. There's nothing in between. What if something has a singular use, a singular purpose, and it fails to live up to it? What good is it? And the gospel of this morning is towards the end. You see that there is something of a very alarming tone, because something like that, it's not even good enough for the rubbish heap. They just simply throw it out, and it is trampled by men. Humanity has a single purpose. It is to worship God, to be in communion with God. It is to proclaim his glory. Like salt, that is the one reason humanity is here. Everything else doesn't matter. But what happens when humanity does not live up to that? When each of us, God forbid, does not live up to that? Salt. Salt has a very distinct taste. It is at the core of what it is. There is no other purpose for it. It's unmistakable. As a Christian, and it's clear, this morning we're reading from the Gospel of St. Luke. In St. Matthew, it's a little bit clearer. In St. Matthew, it tells us explicitly, you are the salt. You are the salt of the earth. That is your primary function. That is your fundamental identity. Everything else, whether I'm a doctor, I'm a lawyer, I'm a beggar, I'm a man, I'm a woman, I'm a child, everything else is completely secondary. Yet, within our world, within our construct, it's amazing how much more effort and emphasis and attention we pay to those secondary things, as opposed to what we are called to be at the core of why we were even created. People's identities are typically forged by what they do. What are you? How do you even perceive yourself? Not even how you describe yourself to others, but how do you perceive yourself? Well, I'm an engineer. I'm a civil engineer. I'm a doctor. I'm a lawyer. Now, ultimately, that has absolutely no bearing. Because once you go before those pearly gates and you go before those angels and you're trying to enter into the kingdom of heaven, and you go there and you tell them, why should we let you in? And you're going to tell them, well, I'm a doctor. They're going to tell you, well, that's nice, but we have no use for you. Nobody gets sick here. I'm an engineer. Good for you. We have no need for engineers. On and on and on. It's until you tell them, I am the son of the king, that then they'll let you in. Then the gates are going to open. Then everything is going to be different, because it's not about what you do. It's about who you are. It's about who you are intrinsically, are the core of your being. That's the primary thing God wants us to be what we are, to be his disciples. We are called to be his disciples. We are called to be his children. Sometimes we make this kind of vague and difficult and, you know, what does God want for me? What does God want me to do in my life? So on and so forth. And that can be a complicated question. But it has, on one level, a very simple answer at the core of it. Whether you're a millionaire or a beggar, whether you're a man, woman, old or young, he wants you to be that salt. He wants to be that disciple. He wants you to be his child. Whatever else you do for this period that we have on earth, all that is good, all that is beneficial, but ultimately all that is gone. All that is immaterial. Don't be kind of salty. Salty from Sunday mornings from 8 to 11. That's not really being salty. Be what you are called to be. We are called to be his disciples. The same one who told us that you are the salt of the earth also told us that you are the light of the world. Now, if salt is fundamental to who we are, if being disciples and children is fundamental to who we are, being light, illuminating, bringing light of Christ into the world is our function. This is what we do. This is a core function of what we do. You are the light of the world. Again, regardless of what you are, what you do in life, if I am a disciple, I must illuminate. If I am a disciple, I have to show God's love, God's presence wherever I am, whether it's that 9-to-5 job, whether it's a more specific role in my life, and we all have multiple roles, whether you're a son, a father, an employee, an employer, and all of these overlap and are replicated, I have to shine. That is my purpose. What does it mean to shine? It means that I show forth Christ. If I'm not showing Christ, if I'm not being a light, then I'm contributing to the darkness. I'm a broken light. Now, what do you do with a broken lamp? What do you do with a broken light bulb? Same thing you do with salt that loses its flavor. It's good for one thing, and it's no longer good for that one thing. It's thrown out. It's no good. There is no other purpose for it. Even when we recycle stuff, and our society is big on recycling and use the material over again, when they recycle it, they don't use it again. They break it down to its base elements, and then they construct it again. You don't get a TV that you recycle, and then you end up with a TV again. You're going to end up with shoes. What do you do with something that fundamentally does not live up to its core purpose? You throw it away. If you are not salt, and if you are not light, we have to kind of pause and think about ourselves and think, well, what am I? What am I doing? If I'm not a disciple of Christ, if I'm not showing Christ in my words, in my actions, in my deeds, in my interactions with my children, my spouse, my family, my employers, if I'm not doing that, then ultimately what am I doing? What good am I? I am a salt that loses its flavor. The good news is for those that want to be salt, but just can't seem to do it. Those that want to be light, but can't seem to do it. That the same one who told us that you are the salt of the earth, you are the light of the world, also said, I am the vine and you are the branches. A vine and a branch. The branch is an extension of the vine, but it is not the vine. It's nourished by the vine. It is organically tied into the vine. That's what makes it a branch. Otherwise, it's a stick. It's a dead stick. I am the vine and you are the branches. If you are in Christ, you cannot help but be the salt of the earth. If you are in Christ, you cannot help but be the light of the world. Because it's no longer you, but it is He working through you. And as I'm pounding the podium this morning, and if you are not, then what is your sole purpose? What is life about? What is the purpose of anything? A branch is organically linked to the vine. How do I fix myself to the vine? It's nothing new. You've heard this 1,000 times. The Word of God. The Word of God is live and active and powerful. You read it, it brings you to closer to God. You have that organic link through the communion. But really pausing, thinking, praying about what you're receiving and what you are to do with that gift you have received. We're approaching a season. We're in a season of fasting now, and I like to think about it more in terms of seasons, as opportunities to do things. Not so much fasting, not fasting per se, but they're seasons, they're opportunities to kind of set goals and to deepen our spiritual lives. And part of the problem we have is that we don't set goals, and hence we don't accomplish anything. And that's not a mystery. Sometimes it seems mysterious. How come I'm all these years going to church, I'm not accomplishing much? I feel like I'm in the same spot I've always been. Well, have you ever set a goal? No. So you didn't set a goal to accomplish something and you accomplished nothing. Where is the mystery there? Let us set goals for this season. If it's simply reading a chapter a day, don't read the whole Gospel of John in one day. You're going to do that one day, then you're not going to read anything else the rest of the time. Just add a little bit. Coming to church just 15 minutes earlier. Not asking you to come an hour earlier. Not telling you to come before Abuna. I don't come before Abuna. But just 15 minutes earlier. Make that your goal. Make that the thing that you're going to change about your life, that you're going to get closer to God. God is like a magnet. The attraction of magnets is exponential. It's not proportional. You come a small distance, you feel the pull much, much greater. Just that one chapter, just those 15 minutes, make that the goal. And make your prayer to God clear. God, I want to be that salt. Make me that salt. Make me that light. And glory be to God forever. Amen.